you kind of get the feeling as you're making something that you are really doing something that is quite important here.
No, it's like a weird dream. I mean, some of these films that I picked, there's ones that I can't kind of watch over because they kind of play over in your mind like a dream.
Ask any member of the forces of law and order, and they will tell you that Satanism as such, it's there, and it has been for thousands of years. Man has worshipped the devil longer than he has worshipped perhaps an established religious figure.
They're talking about remaking it in America with Nicolas Cage, but I don't know what they're going to do.
It is time to keep your appointment with the Wicker Man.
Hello, my summer children. I hope you've been drinking in the sun. Of course, I broke out the Midsommar crown to talk about its granddaddy, the Wicker Man. If you're new here, hi, I'm Kylie. I'm obsessed with cult movies, probably because I have my own cult, the Cult of Haunted Hippie. Welcome! If you want to join, we would love to have you. The difference between me and Lord Summer Isle is that I'm very upfront about it. There's no brainwashing. Like, you can leave at any time. But I hope you don't. I hope you click subscribe and stick around for a while. Click that like button, the notification bell, that way you never miss the next video. Because we talk about all types of fun stuff here, and this is a video I've been excited for all summer. Today is an original versus remake deep dive of The Wicker Man, of which the original is one of the best movies ever made. I'm gonna start with the behind the scenes stories of how these movies got made, inspirations, casting, making of, distribution, reception. Then I'll cover the most notable plot differences in each film. I'll also put a slight emphasis on the different cuts of each movie, certain cut scenes, alternate endings, etc. Then I want to talk style, the costuming, the effects, the acting. After that, I'll finish off the video talking about the themes in each film. If that sounds good to you, sit back, relax, grab a snack, and let's dive into the Citizen Kane of horror films. I know you would probably believe me if I told you that this script was written specifically for Christopher Lee, but that was a surprising element that came up in my research. Screenwriter Anthony Schaffer was interested in making a horror film without following what he considered to be the tired trends of the Hammer horror films. If you're a fellow Gen Z girly, maybe you're not super familiar, but Hammer horror films dominated the horror genre from the 1950s to the 1970s. Hammer Film Productions is the British company that produced such movies as The Curse of Frankenstein, Dracula starring Christopher Lee, and The Mummy. Lee has Hammer Films to thank for his rise to fame, starring in seven Dracula films from 1957 to 1973. After spending so much time in the role, he became a little bit displeased with the lack of range he was able to explore with the character.
They had in mind a very unusual project, and they wanted me to play one of the leads. So I went there, and we chatted and talked. They weren't very specific, either of them. All that was discussed was the fact that they were going to write the part for me.
Another notable inspiration for the screenplay was Ritual, a novel written by David Pinner. That is the novel that the movie is based on. Schaffer, Lee, and producer Peter Snell acquired the rights to produce this movie for just £5,000, but they ran into a problem because they realized that the book was kind of boring and they weren't really sure how they were going to adapt it. In comes director Robin Hardy. The script had been in development for nearly 18 months when Schaffer decided to get in contact with Hardy to brainstorm. After all that time, the two of them were basically able to lock in the final story after just one weekend of writing together. Of course, a lot of research went into the creation of the culture on the island, most of it being derived from the Celts, particularly druids, who were the high-ranking officials of these pagan cultures. Here are some of the beliefs they possessed that might have influenced the film. They believed that animals, rocks, plants, the weather, everything in nature contained spirits. They believed in fairies, who were vengeful beings that they made sacrifices to. They would bury offerings to these beings, or sometimes throw these offerings into bodies of water. On rare occasions, they would sacrifice infants, usually if they were moving into a new home. The Wicker Man itself was the object of fertility rituals, and the maypole represented the phallus, which they would dance around.
The May Day Festival is a very specific play called the Marasco play, or the Marasco dance, which goes back into the mists of time. It's certainly pre-Christian. There's always a teaser, there's always a hobby horse. It's about the renewal of life. The hobby horse covers the women to make them fertile, to make them have babies. It was a sort of, you know, pagan idea.
What has also been confirmed is that the music in the movie came from Robin Hardy's research on druids. The filmmakers were especially interested in creating a society that was the antithesis to then modern day Christianity, but they still needed the perfect guy to represent those Protestant vibes at the center of the film. So who would be cast as Sergeant Howie? Would you believe they originally wanted Peter Cushing to play the role? And it also bounced around to a few other people. But of course, the role went to Edward Woodward, who is in fact not Scottish. Luckily, he spent 4 years of his life living in Scotland, which helped him with his accent, and also landing a few other Scottish roles in his career. One of my favorite fun facts about his character is that they made his uniform one size too small to emphasize his stiffness. In fact, Woodward could hardly even sit down in the outfit. On the contrary, Christopher was doing a fair amount of just freely running around in this movie, having a good time, and is one of the best casting choices of all time, in my opinion.
I got paid nothing, and I keep repeating that to people, and they don't believe it, but it is true. I've got the contract, which proves it. Sometimes you do things for love. Point was that if they paid me my normal fee, and if they paid Peter Snell as executive producer his normal fee, and everybody else their normal fees, the budget would have been, you know, unrealistic, and they wouldn't have been able to make the film.
You heard him, not a lot of money going around, and there was drama in literally every phase of this production. Before production began, a young entrepreneur had purchased British Lion, which was funding this movie. Well, that was the parent company of an offshoot studio called Shepperton, which everyone was nervous about shutting down once the ownership changed. On the contrary, they were rushed into production quickly to put everyone at ease that they would actually be producing films. But they were only given $500,000, and so making this movie was its own type of hell, as is always the case with our favorite classics, isn't it? First of all, they shot in October and November, and a good amount of this movie takes place outside, so it was freezing cold. It was so cold that the extras had to put ice in their mouth to stop their breath from steaming. They also had horrible snow and rain that impeded on their shooting schedule. If they were shooting indoors and the sun came out, they would drop everything and run to shoot outside, so it would throw their whole schedule off. But that's just movie biz, baby. Like, it's very rare to be on a set where the schedule is actually strictly followed. Although, I don't know, I've never been on a union set. Must be nice. Maybe you could have figured the final scene of the movie was the hardest to shoot for many reasons. First of all, the schedule got moved around to accommodate good weather. This meant that Edward Woodward had a bit of a freak out. He was like, I can't learn all these lines overnight. So they ended up stringing up huge cue cards for him to read, and he still killed it. Prior to shooting this scene, there also were rumors circulating that they were going to be burning real animals in The Wicker Man. Animal rights activists were all over this. There were petitions drawn up, and were they burning real animals? No, but there was some distress, to say the least.
It wasn't me in the very final stages of The Wicker Man, but it was me right up until the final stage, and that was pretty frightening, I must say.
Poor Edward Woodward was shut up in The Wicker Man, and above him, one floor up above him, was a goat. And the goat was rather frightened, and when you're frightened, you urinate frequently. And poor Edward Woodward suffered here.
It was very tricky, very dangerous, very worrying. However, you know, you do these things when you're young.
Not only was Woodward getting peed on by that goat, but remember, it's freezing out, so I bet that that pee turned icy on his skin. He also had to put his feet between actress Ingrid Pitt's legs because they were so cold they were turning blue. It might have been from the cold as well that he suffered a pretty bad injury. Whether it was fractured or just badly bruised, he didn't know, but he woke up with a really sore foot and he tried to stand up, but it gave out under him. They just ended up binding it tightly and kept on working. It was all worth it, I think, because it ended up being one of the most breathtaking final shots in cinema history. They didn't think that they would ever practically get that in one take with the burning man and getting the sunset. At that time, a shot would have most likely been accomplished via a blue screen, like the one that you see on the backlot tour of Universal Studios. They saved a lot of money doing it practically, and it looked so much better than it would have with the screen. It's one of those shots that I know that when they called cut, everybody just started hooting and hollering, just cheering. Maybe the most prime example of unfiltered movie magic.
Everybody who's ever seen this film has always said to me, from now to the very end, it is one of the most horrifying things they've ever seen. And I've said, yes, indeed, it is horrifying in the best sense of the word. And it's intended to be. And I've also always said, it's the only logical conclusion to the story. Yes. There could not be any
Nobody
other
believes
ending.
That it's going to happen the way it happens.
We can debate Chris on that a little later, but this brings us to the distribution of this film. Like I said, there was drama from start to finish on this one. By this time, the studio had been bought by EMI, and British Lion was now being managed by Michael Healy. If you're interested in the history of the ownership of the studios and everything, because I know I didn't really get all into that, for clarification, if you want to pause and read here, here's the segment on British Lion's ownership history at the time Wicker Man was being made. This is the Wikipedia page on the company. I don't really concern myself with all those intricacies because I just don't care about business. But these guys caused everyone a bit of a headache, okay?
So at that point, we had already finished the fine cut of the film, the director's cut, and a copy of it had already gone to Roger Corman.
We were distributing for Bergman,
Fellini, Truffaut, a number of European directors, and I saw this picture as something that would be somewhere between an art film and a commercial film.
I've said it before, I will say it again. To the general public who doesn't know, Roger Corman is such an undeniable pillar of this industry. He was a titan of propping it up, okay? We spoke about him recently and he continues to come up because he had a hand in so many of our favorite classics and the B-movie industry. Anyway, he put up what he thought was a reasonable advance to distribute the film, but the new management was looking for as much cash as possible. Another entity ended up bidding more, and so they got it. The new management also decided that the film was too long, and they took it out of Hardy's hands completely and trimmed out 13 to 15 minutes. Then they lost the negatives of the original cut of the film. The director's cut was thought to be completely lost, which was heart-wrenching, but who should save the day but Roger Corman? He was the only one that held on to his negative of the film, and so the director's cut literally survived because of him. So let's discuss some of these cut scenes that were nearly lost in time. In the original cut, the opening was supposed to start on the mainland. They really wanted to establish the sergeant as a total prick, but that ultimately proved unnecessary and, in Hardy's words, not mine, boring. One of the most discussed cut scenes is also pretty early on in the film. The scene shows Lord Summerisle presenting a young woman with a young man. Then you see some snail coitus, which is pretty crazy, but it's simulating what's going on with the humans.
Well, we see Christopher Lee in the garden and the snails and all that is absolutely essential to the sense of the film. That's what's been cut out of the, let's call it the British version. It's called the theatrical version, but it's really the version that's been shown here over all these years. And putting it back makes sense of the film.
I don't know that I agree with that because I feel like there is an underlying current of that feeling going on anyways. But Hardy also said in the DVD commentary that you probably will not find a single director out there that doesn't want the longest possible cut of their film. For The Wicker Man, the legendary original cut has been referenced by some to be 102 minutes long. The original theatrical cut was cut down to 87 minutes. Corman had a copy that was 99 minutes long, and a restored version was released that was 96 minutes long in 1979. The cut history of this movie is a little bit ridiculous. A lot of it is hearsay. I don't want to get too lost in the weeds, but to finish it off here, I own the gorgeous 50th edition 4K Blu-ray. This features the theatrical cut, the director's cut, and the final cut. The theatrical cut is listed at 88 minutes, the director's cut is 101 minutes, and the final cut is 94 minutes. Legend has it, there are a few minutes of this movie that have indeed been fully lost to time, and for his whole life, I don't think that Christopher Lee ever let that go.
I have no proof. I just feel that this happened, and I'm not going to go into the matter any further. I have my own opinions. Some people share them. Other people think I'm wrong. I've said this at some considerable length because I think it's enormously important. One of the best British pictures ever made should not only be cut to bits, but that when you want to re-edit it, I was quite prepared to pay for it to be re-edited and mixed. I think it's an absolute disgrace and a shame on the British film industry with a major company like British Lion that a film should disappear 30 years ago and never be seen again. How does a film disappear unless it's deliberate? I mean, it could be a mistake, but I personally have my doubts.
I still believe it exists somewhere. In cans with no name. But I still believe that. But nobody's ever seen it since. So we couldn't re-cut it, re-edit it, which is what I wanted to do. It would have been 10 times as good.
It's insane to me that you have the Citizen Kane of horror films, like one of the most perfect movies ever made, and then the stars, like it could have been 10 times better, I swear to God. We'll just have to take his word for it, but I am personally grateful for what we do have, and so were a lot of people. I want to talk about the reception of this film. Sometimes classics take a while to catch on, and that's somewhat the case with this movie. It had a slow start and has since gained so much critical acclaim. It went from a cult classic to, I think now, pretty much a certified classic. Because Lee was so passionate about this film, he actually rung up all of the critics that he knew, and he offered to pay for their seats to go watch this movie. According to him, nobody called in that favor, though. They all went on their own, they paid for their own tickets, and the response was unanimous. David McGillivray of the Monthly Film Bulletin praised the movie, saying, "Absolute nonsense, of course, and yet it is so persuasively written by the remarkably agile-minded Anthony Schaffer, that few will be able to suppress a shudder as the awful truth finally dawns, relentlessly building an atmosphere of unease that is more akin to that of his brother Peter's electrifying play than anything he himself has hitherto written for the screen." The writer manipulates the mechanics of the mystery thriller with a sly delight. They tried to keep the ball rolling. The filmmakers did everything in their power to keep getting the word out.
Christopher Lee cooperated magnificently in helping us publicize this movie, often going to small towns like Jacksonville, Mississippi.
My delight, my work goes forward day and night. We went to Baton Rouge, which was the University of Louisiana. The moment that film was shown to the young students, it took off all around the world.
Once again, he was paid dirt for his involvement of this movie, remember? And then he went on to publicize the hell out of it for free. This was an actor with taste, class, and critical engagement with the projects that he worked on. And then he ended his career with some goofy fun shit with Tim Burton. How I wish I could resurrect that man to have a cup of coffee with him. Now, there is one demographic that you might be curious about. What did the Bible Thumpers think of this film?
When we showed this in the Bible Belt in the United States, where they're very fundamentalist Christians, we were very afraid that they would, you know, really hate the film. Quite the reverse. We had sort of prayer breakfasts organized by the distributors, and we'd meet with a whole bunch of ministers and priests for breakfast. It's a very American thing. And they were very, very for the film because they said it actually represented Christianity accurately, you know, the sense of belief in resurrection and so on, that they had ever seen another film. Therefore recommended it from the pulpit.
I think this film is one of the biggest contenders for best mirror. Art holds a mirror up to you. Whatever you read in a film is often what's already inside of you. All your bias and beliefs inform your analysis of such things. The fact that this film can actually be read in both ways is so fascinating to me. We will break that down further in the theme portion of this video. This movie won Best Film at the Paris International Festival of Fantastic and Science Fiction Film in 1974, but then the movie slipped into obscurity a bit. It wasn't until 1977 that the American film magazine Cine Fantastique branded it as the Citizen Kane of horror films. This is largely its legacy. That is still a phrase that is commonly connected with this film, and I don't think that that's an unfounded appraisal at all. Christopher Lee said in the making of that regardless of bad conditions or lack of pay, it was a good experience because he knew that they were making something extraordinary. Edward Woodward says that he looks back on this period of his life with such joy that it was such an important time to him. I'll let them tell you.
And I suppose the greatest thing that can happen to an actor is even if just once in his life or her life, you do something that lasts. So, that's a great warm feeling.
Simply speaking as an actor, speaking, as the actor who was fortunate enough to play the part, fortunate enough to play Lord Summerisle, I can only say that it's by far the best part I've ever had, and the best written part in the most absorbing, fascinating, and challenging film that I've ever worked in.
Over and above the Orson Welles production or
Indeed,
The Three Musketeers?
Over and above, including every film I've ever made. This, to me, was not only one of the greatest challenges to me as an actor, but was certainly the most fascinating film I've ever been involved in. It's the best script I've ever, ever had.
So many warm, fuzzy feelings, and I do hate to drag us down here, but we do need to start talking about the remake. I'm not really going in depth with the remake. There were not many press interviews done. There is not a lot of recorded history on it. As always, there is a master resource post in the description box down below if you do want to look into the resources that I did find. This movie is just kind of a thing that exists, but I do have a few fun tidbits for you. Before that, there were actually a good amount of related works that were released in between these movies, including a novelization released in 1978. In 1989, Schaffer wrote a 30-page script treatment called The Loathsome Lambton Worm, in which Sergeant Howie would have survived. I'm pretty thankful we didn't get that sequel, to be honest with you, because the ending is just so perfect. It caps off a perfect standalone film, especially because his plans would have involved way more effects. Sergeant Howie would have battled a dragon at one point. I'm so serious. Hardy himself had released a book and was also planning what was basically going to be a remake, with Christopher Lee attached to star as a born-again Christian that ends up on the island. It was announced in April of 2000, but production didn't begin until 2009, probably largely due to the actual remake that went underway, and Hardy's project turned into more of a spiritual sequel that was called The Wicker Tree, released in 2011. That one has a 20% on Rotten Tomatoes, and I'll be honest, I haven't given that one a go. But when it comes to the actual remake, Universal Studios had been planning on making it since the 1990s. According to the director's commentary, Neil LaBute was approached by Nicolas Cage's production company to direct this movie. LaBute was a fairly decorated writer, but to this day, he's not really known for much directorial work. One of his recent projects you may have seen in 2022 was House of Darkness, starring our favorite boy, Justin Long. It's nothing amazing, but I found it to be really enjoyable. I actually would recommend that movie. The most shocking and interesting thing that I learned about the remake was the involvement involvement of a one Johnny Ramone. Not necessarily his involvement, but just the fact that he was so influential in actually getting it made. Again, for any youngins out there, Johnny Ramone is the guitarist and founding member of the band The Ramones. I don't wanna be buried in a pet cemetery. Those guys.
Why did you choose to do The Wicker Man?
It was a personal reason to begin with. My friend, a punk rocker, Johnny Ramone, who's no longer with us, was a huge fan of horror films. And I would go to his house and we would watch his favorite movies, and he had a list of ones that I had never seen. And he mentioned The Wicker Man, and I was aware of it because I'd seen the poster for it when I was a boy, but mysteriously the movie never really came out, or I didn't have access to it. And I watched the film with Johnny, and I was profoundly affected, especially by the end of the movie. And so I thought to myself, well, wouldn't it be interesting to kind of bring this back? Not too many people I know are aware of it.
Wasn't there also a point, even when close to his death, that he asked you again about the movie?
He was in the hospital, and he, and I think what was not unlike a haze, he asked about The Wicker Man. Is Nick doing The Wicker Man?
So, which, in fact, we dedicated at the end of the movie for Johnny
Ramone.
Yeah,
so if you stick with us through the movie, you'll see for Johnny Ramone at the end.
Now, Johnny was a staunch conservative, Reagan-praising weirdo, so it doesn't really surprise me that he lacked the taste and foresight to realize that this remake was a bad idea. Anyway, by 2005, the remake rights had moved from Universal Studios to Millennium Films, and they shot the film in Vancouver in July, so production was fairly easy. Of the 45-day shoot, they only had one day of rain. Again, they're just weren't many promotional materials. The only physical media with special features that I could find is the one that I own. There are two cuts of the movie, the theatrical and the unrated, and there is a director's commentary, and yes, it's boring. So the main thing to go over here is the cut comparison. In the theatrical ending, we meet James Franco in a bar where he hits on Nick Cage's character's ex-wife, and he's like, yeah, I just graduated from the police academy, and the other girl is like, wanna take me home tonight? And the scene inexplicably ends with a sound bite of Nick Cage screaming. It implies, of course, that the cycle will continue, but the unrated cut is a lot more fun. We see the ritual in all its glory with Nick Cage's head getting caged. Love what they did there. This is where we get the infamous,
oh, no, not the beast! Not the beast!
Really great stuff, just classic Nick Cage realness. Needless to say, this goofy, soulless movie did not receive a positive reaction. On a budget of $40 million, it went on to gross $38.8 million worldwide. The studio for sure lost some money on that one, especially when you factor in the marketing budget, even if it wasn't that big. Joe Layden wrote for Variety in 2006. At first, it's modestly amusing to see how LaBute, the writer-director of such notoriously nasty battles of the sexes as Your Friends and Neighbors and In the Company of Men, develops the concept of a normally competent, doggedly rational man, a cop no less, who is repeatedly frustrated and humiliated in a matriarchal society based on ancient religious rituals. But the novelty of this role reversal, in the company of Wiccans, anyone, wears thin long before the pick plods to its predictable conclusion, and any provocative questions LaBute might have wanted to raise are totally obscured as the rising tide of absurdity gradually overwhelms the entire enterprise. It currently sits at a 15% on Rotten Tomatoes and a 1.9% on Letterboxd, whereas the original film sits at a 4.0. The top review of the remake being a quote of the unrated cut's ending, naturally. It was nominated for 5 Razzies, and it didn't even win a single one. Robin Hardy even had his lawyer make Warner Bros. Remove his name from the promotional materials. He was inexplicably given credit on the screenplay when he wasn't even given credit on the screenplay of the original movie. Beforehand, Christopher Lee was very skeptical of this remake. He even said, "They all seem pretty desperate in the film and television world. The Wicker Man was probably the best film I've ever made, and it became, next to Citizen Kane, the biggest cult movie in the world, and it still has people talking about it. And then I hear it's being remade. I don't believe in remakes. You can make a follow-up to a film, but to remake a movie with such history and success just doesn't make sense to me." Talk your shit, Chris, honestly. When it came out, his concerns were validated. I also highly recommend listening to the audio commentary in its entirety because it's so hilarious. He's like, at one point, they even said that they wanted me to star in the remake, and I was like, well, what role role would I play? The Wicker Man? In my opinion, I feel like the remake was largely brushed off due to the existence of the original. I think this movie could have been viewed as like just a regular go to the theater then forget about it, 3-star, like whatever, fine time. But to jump to the plot comparison here, I think that the remake is so boring because so much of it is just an obvious slog through the original plot. One of the only appealing elements I think is the beginning, which I'll admit was shocking to me in my first viewing. We start on the mainland and Nick Cage attempts to save a woman and young girl from a burning car only to fail and have the memory haunt him. Also, usually if Nick Cage is in a movie, I never reference him by his character's name. I always still call him Nick Cage. I'm sorry if that's confusing. But anyway, another element that I thought could have really worked well is the fact that his character is trying to track down his ex-wife on this island. That coupled with the community of the remake being a matriarchal society. Those are super cool things that I think could have had a lot of thematic depth, but they were just sort of there. And it didn't help that the production just felt super lifeless. Somehow they got Ellen Burstyn to agree to this, and she plays the matriarch version of Lord Summerisle. She's probably my favorite element of this movie, but she's just not really given much to do. She's also the vessel through which I want to explore the style of these movies, so let's talk about wigs, first of all. I love a good wig moment in a movie, but unfortunately, as I age, they become so much easier to spot. I love this witchy fairy look they were going for by giving her this luscious head of white hair, but we're not meant to clock this as a wig. Then you take Christopher Lee, giddily running around in what is obviously a ludicrous wig, implementing humor to make an uncomfortable situation even more unnerving. There is nothing worse than not knowing if you're allowed to laugh, and I'll stand by that.
I think it's wonderful in this sequence that the way Edward does his dance, completely out of step with everyone else.
Yes. I had to make sure that I wasn't in step.
I made up all my movements and dancing.
Oh, I think your dance is marvelous, and your gym shoes.
Yes, I wore that on purpose. To make it look, you know, bring in a sense of the ridiculous into it for a moment.
Sometimes to be serious, you have to lean into absurdity. I can't fully explain it, I just know it to be true. It's like how the best comedic actors are playing things straight in absurd situations. They are playing a serious situation absurdly, it's just the reverse. The remake is way too self-serious. Like, instead of leaning into these social faux pas to make us more uncomfortable, they end up going over the top to try to be scary, and you're laughing at it for the wrong reasons.
And that, my friend, is your destiny.
It is your destiny.
Back up!
This movie makes me burst out laughing when I know that it's not the intention. The original lets you ruminate on the intentions of these islanders. It makes you unpack your own beliefs about social constructs and Christianity. It doesn't need any fluff. The goofy costumes do their magic to kind of throw you off balance. You may experience a bit of a whiplash when you're like, oh, these people are just silly. Look at their costumes. Oh no, they're gonna cut someone's head off. Oh my god. Oh no, they're just being silly. The remake does none of that. It copies some of the aesthetics of the original without having an understanding of why those stylistic choices were implemented in the first place. They really just went, have you ever imagined 2 scary women? The matriarchal component could have been so thematically resonant. Could have been a text documenting the classic misogynistic fear of women in powerful positions, but it just wasn't. The movie was a big stew of nothing. That's why the commentary was so boring and why I shared nothing from it. Oh no, maybe my fun fact about the weather came from the commentary actually. It just seemed like nobody was really critically engaging with the work that they were making. Then on the other hand, you have Robin Hardy.
Well, I think this film awakes in people a kind of tribal memory. It's full of echoes from our past, from our childhood, from the very things that are around us in every day. We go to church on Sunday and we forget that Sunday was originally a day when we worshiped the sun.
Because it has a way of making people uncomfortable in a good, a healthy kind of way. It provokes a thought process, an examination of oneself and where one's at.
There's a very good reason for that, I think, Sterling, and that is because those things which are part of our superstitions, which are part of so many of our everyday, or accepted as everyday, customs that we do at various times of the year and so on and so forth, are things that for a long time were banned, because for centuries the church, for all sorts of reasons, because they were connected in something in our tribal memory, tried to make us forget where they came from. The pagans in our film aren't just plain evil, they are trying to make sure that the gods give them a chance to have a a good tomorrow.
Maybe you heard it here first. I feel like the pagans are low-key the protagonists of this film, and I think that Robin Hardy seems to agree. Sergeant Howie represents the deeply unfortunate end result of patriarchal fundamental Christianity. It turned him stuck up, extremely judgmental, entitled, and dying a virgin. Having any belief system inform your entire life is just a bad call, and I think that's really what the entire movie is about, because it happens on both ends. The cult here aren't the good guys, right, because they murdered someone, but those actions were also dictated by their beliefs. But Christianity, not a lot better. A lot of wars, a lot of millions of people dying because of that religion. So on both ends, there existed pure intentions. And I think that this movie exposes humanity for fighting and dying over belief systems that should not inform how society functions. Now, some closing thoughts to wind us down. The Wicker Man is one of my favorite horror movies ever made. Maybe just one of my favorite movies ever made. I thought that I would be able to have fun with the remake, kind of bask in early 2000s cheesiness, watch a good Nick Cage freak out, and I just didn't really get that. I did have fun doing all this research, and I wish that I could have brought more for you. A documentary was actually announced just last year by the sons of Robin Hardy. Justin and Dominic announced a documentary called Wicker Mania, and it looks like they've met their 25,000 pound goal, and I am stoked for them. I cannot wait for this documentary's release. There's also an official story of the film book that was released last year as well, and I saw it in Barnes & Noble. It is beautiful. But it's also $50, and I just realistically couldn't afford that, even as a business expense. But someday I will throw that beautiful book on my coffee table. Of course, we could also stay here all day and talk about various movies that The Wicker Man inspired. One of my favorites, and the most obvious, being Midsommar, which is another one of my favorite movies of all time, and if you are interested in a deep dive of that movie, then look no further. I released that video last May. But that's all from me. If you made it to the end of this video, then I appreciate you so much. Should we pull a prank on everyone that didn't make it in the comments? Okay, here's our code. If you made it to the end, include the word Scotland in your comment. Okay, shout out to the Scots. Love you guys. It'll be our little secret. But if you want more content from me, then check out the other deep dives on my channel. Like I mentioned, I also have reviews. I have other original versus remake comparisons. I have franchise deep dives. I have a second channel where I post travel vlogs and also a ton of videos about physical media. I also have a Patreon with several different tiers of bonus content for you to enjoy. Huge shout out to the patrons for keeping this channel funded. They are the reason why I can pour my everything into these deep dives. You can also find my social media linked down below as always, but more than anything, I just hope that you enjoyed this video, and I hope I catch you in the next one. Bye!